vastly, where it divides and slides down into the crevices of cracked tiles. I can almost hear the screams of silverfish rudely awakened. They slither out of their lodgings and disappear just so quickly under the sink. I admire the alternative in the alternatives insects, the alternative insects. Yeah, I dig the alternative insect music. I admire the alternatives insects have in the way of housing. They're the only ones getting over in New York City. The movie ends. A priest comes on the air and conveys a rather tick-in-the-eye-like platitude. I have no idea what that means, tick-in-the-eye-like platitude. I am out of action by the water's heat. I want to get up, but my brain is steamed to mush and ether, and I can't hack the idea of standing up into the vicious chill of this winter apartment. I decide to turn the tap back on to fortify the heat and wait it out until the radiators start steaming, thus equalizing the ratio of water and room temperatures. Since I have no book in there with me, I'm stranded with my own thoughts. The TV channel has just signed off after the national anthem played, with a backdrop of Titan missiles launched and flooding the sky. You need a color TV to fully appreciate some images, I suppose. Then there's a test pattern and an annoying tone of high frequency. How come there's always that Indian head on the test pattern? I turn the sound down. What if I were to knock the TV into the water as I was turning the knob, I think? I wonder if the effect of the shock would be agony or pleasure, or if at that point, one could tell the difference. For that matter, I wonder if the moment of death itself would be, no, no way. I don't care if the TV's bare. I'm not getting into that shit. Not in a red bathtub. Not with the water so hot. Not lobster metaphysics. I'm just glad I walked away from that slime at that jury party last night. No matter how fine the woman or how hard they came on, I think I did learn some things in California. I believe I have moved closer to my heart. I feel comfortable in reclusion. I don't need the vacant flux of parties. I don't need my own attendance at art happenings, which are for the most part excuses for the party afterwards. But I don't want to become a cynical prick either. It is, after all, a human universe. Knowledge, the hunger for detail, even the learned trivia, it does give way to wisdom if you don't push, if you sit back and remove the clutter of lips and claws and capsules and punch. I know I am a cold-hearted motherfucker, but I have moved closer to my heart. Solitude will do that. Strange how long it takes to write out notions that pass by in seconds while laid out in a red bathtub waiting for the first sounds of the heat rising in the radiator. I'm halfway to sleep now, though my painter friend Larry does it all the time, sleeps in the tub. I only fell asleep once in a bathtub. That was a long time ago. I shut my eyes now and words pass over the lids, which feel like they have been scraped out clean, hollowed out, and stuffed with words a long time ago when I was in a tub. That was when I thought an oxymoron was a beautiful flower, white with blue bands most likely, with those thin stems with globes at the end like honeysuckle growing from the center. A tournament for winged insects. Words passing upright like troops for inspection before my eyes. Ichor, uxorious. Uxorious, I think, means a person, who's too obsessively in love with his wife. Not too many of us have to worry about that one. ichneumon, thump, vadophobia, which is the fear of starving to death in a stalled elevator. Vadophobia. You know, I always thought it was just fear of elevators, but when I read it was the fear of starving to death in a stalled elevator, I thought it was great. They all pass by. I hear the wasp-like hiss of the radiators that have woken me from my sleep, from dreaming of words, and later of women in 1920 hairdos and modern lingerie. 2 hours have passed, and my body is the color and texture of a cauliflower. When I first woke, I panicked, seeing the red globs on the bath of the tub's bottom. I thought I was trapped with a hideous wound in the engine room of some sinking luxury liner, just threading above a decreasing water line. I snapped out fast, however. The elapsed time had lowered the water to a sobering temperature, and I was out quickly, toweling off beside the thick heat pipe, emitting heat from floor to ceiling. I put on my robe and carried the TV into the bedroom, placing it on its usual crate. I could have fallen asleep immediately, I guess, but I read a bit, watched the TV without sound. The roadrunner is zipping through deserts, leaving the coyote reading a manual in thick clouds of dust. The silence is eerie. It always is at this time of night in New York City. All that time spent in the country, out in California, sleeping to the orchestrations of strange tiny things making strange loud noises, has given me an awareness of this city's silence, which makes it staggering and at times plain fearsome. After all, I grew up with this silence, and I'm not talking about the sounds of the Village or 42nd Street here. Those places are nonstop, might as well be Vegas. I'm talking about the New York neighborhoods, the outer boroughs and upper Manhattan, the areas where the people live on a time of working stiffs, blue collar. The silence is almost visual. You expect shadowless things to dart out. You anticipate the most horrific scenes. With the quick fall of high heels on subway gratings, your spine pulls up like a horse rearing, and you're always expecting the scream to come of women or air raid sirens. Then there is a sound of sweet continuity, the perorations of morning, the bakery trucks with 20-year-old transmissions, their gears changing so loudly as the construction site at noon in Midtown. The news trucks at 5:30 a.m., where the guy yells out and the bales of the New York Times hit the pavement with a stiffer thump than the News or the Post. An old guy who wears the same red and black flannel jacket and cap in the heat of summer and the freeze of winter mutters something back through toothless gums, then rises off his milk crate and slices the stacks of information open like hay with a wicked razor knife. A few faithful dog walkers waiting for the Times hand him change. I can hear the change. Then separate their tangled leashes and split in different directions. And the garbage trucks, I almost forgot, they come earlier, maybe 4 a.m. They break the silence with otherworldly noises. When I was a kid, I always thought when their sound sometimes woke me that early that they were aliens on Broadway disposing of humans who had found them out like meat through a grinder. The sound made me press my teeth together and grind so hard my jaw would ache all day through Catholic school. But the Department of Sanitation has already come and gone for tonight, or today. I put down my book. It's 4:45 a.m. I pull the plug on the TV. The flashing ghosts on the screen condense deep into themselves, then blackness. I'm about to turn off the light when I notice the green slime leaking down my forearm. The indestructible abscess in the pit of my elbow, which should be celebrating its second birthday any time now, is really overflowing tonight. It's no wonder, now that I think about it, all that time submerged in the bath, the hot water loosening up all that awful crud. It's drooling from the same tiny opening at the bottom. I grab a tissue, spit on it, and wipe my forearm clean. Normally, when it leaks so profusely, I am tempted to have a go at the thing, to squeeze. See, you gotta understand, in earlier ones, I referred to this abscess, and there's one where I wore this really tight, like, long-sleeve shirt, you know? Like, really tight, like, almost like, you know, like spandex or something, and such, I was ahead of my time. And so it was tight, hot, and the movie theater got real hot, so I was, you know, it was the middle of winter, everybody's taking off all these coats and stuff, and I peeled down to that final layer, but it was still very hot in there, so I'm like sweating underneath this thing, and it's pressing against it for all this time. And when we're leaving the theater, this, my older woman, lover, and I, I wait until everybody else puts their coats on at their seats, you know, but I wait till I get to the fucking middle of the lobby and I'm like blocking everybody from getting out, you know? And then just as I pull up my sleeves, you know, because it feels itchy here, and of this like really tight shirt, and when I just pull it up to like there, this like incredible glob of green slime flies across the lobby like projectile vomit or something. And everybody's going, whoa, hey, watch out, alligator shoes, brother. You know? And that set off a chain reaction of like people running out to the curb puking and shit, you know. It was a hideous scene. So it's kind of given me trouble throughout the years. It's fine now. There's still a scar there, but it's gone. It's gone. There you go. Okay, so normally when it leaks so profusely, I'm tempted to have a go at the thing, to squeeze the feisty sauce from all angles, hoping it will finally burst totally and set its healing in motion. But I'm too wiped out for the challenge, which is exactly what this thing has become. It tempts me with a drop of ooze, and for hours I'm in a free-for-all with all my gross nemesis pinching and piercing from right and left, up and down. It always wins. I thought I was going to say that. It always wins. I extract a bit of the vile fluid from the sauce, but the sauce remains intact. The fucking doctor told me that it's not worth lancing, that it will heal itself. They don't have to deal with its spite, its enticements to self-mutilation, the exhaustion of its resistance, body, mind, spirit, and soul. It's taken on demonic proportions. Shit, I've sanctified the motherfucker. I caress it in my sleep. It's true. My girlfriend told me, like, still to this day, when I'm sleeping, I always sleep on my back, and I guess it's from drug days. You know, they always say you move at night. I never move from, like, this one position, laying with my face up and my hands like this. The only way I move is in the middle of the night, my arm, this one with the abscesses, goes up in the air, and I start, like, caressing it like really sensually, you know? It's amazing. My girlfriend thought it was weird at first, then she thought it was so funny that she kind of like tried to entice me, lift it up, and I pretend I was sleeping and I'd catch her like trying to, because she'd always give me a report the next morning how bad I did it. But I sleep by myself these days, but I still know I'm doing it. I should put a string there or something to see if I'm moving it up there, you know? But I don't know. I mean, actually, it may not be just for the, you know, the caressing it and sanctifying the abscess and the needle. It's also because, like, my first androgynous zone when I was about 5 and 6 years old was like rubbing myself here. It felt really good. And then under this arm, you know? It was, yeah, this right here, though, man, it was really, it still feels kind of good. So, I sanctified the motherfucker. I caress it in my sleep. I'm just going to accept it. I'm tired. I reach again for the light, but I hesitate. Maybe just one little tweak. I mean, that fucker was really flowing. I've wiped it twice, and there's still slime reappearing. There was a little hole in the bottom, which it did come out from, but it would never come all the way. All right, then, but just one shot at it. Just a survey of the situation. I'm too tired. Getting beaten down would only wake me up. I extend my right arm, which contains the beastly little apparatus. I take my left hand and, with thumb and forefinger on opposite sides of the wound, seek out the proper dimensions to attack. This is the point when, no matter how often I failed, my hopes are revivified. My stomach tightens. I think about my cat choking from an abscess in his throat back in California, and the wonderful feeling I had of opening that wound after finally finding it, watching the scum pour out. He looked like an owl. His cheeks and everything was, he was going to choke to death. You know, and I didn't know where it was. I thought it was in his mouth. I poured vodka in and was like stabbing it with like a pin. And finally, I saw a little ooze leaking from right here. I took him in the bathtub and went, and it was like, you know, an inch layer on the entire bathtub, man. It was rank smelling shit. But it was great to hear he could breathe again, you know? It was great to feel like, oh, thanks a lot, man. Because it happened in one morning. He was fine in the morning. It shows how quick those things happen, cats. But I think about my cat choking from an abscess back in California, the wonderful feeling of opening it, watching the scum pour out, and the sound of the creature breathing anew, sucking in the air of another chance. I want that sensation. No matter how much I've cleaned up, this hole in my arm is still an emblem of my addiction, a memorial tattoo that I myself inscribed, as if for an old lover, in homage to that sickness I took years to perfect. My fingers are in place, a little farther apart than usual. A strange feeling creeps over me, like when I was a ball player and I somehow knew I was in the zone and somehow knew I couldn't miss, just a sense from my fingertips. I pinch the two fingers together, slow and steady, that strange sensation guiding me to apply just the right pressure, as it did with my fingertips years ago when I aimlessly released a basketball at the hoop. The funky slime is rapidly escaping. It feels looser beneath the skin than before from all that time in the hot tub as I slept in it, the hot water. But still, there is no final burst. I increase the pressure, changing the angles of my thumb. I press tighter. Green gunk seeps out, dripping from my arm. The feeling has my head reeling. I can't miss. I can't miss now. Tighter now. Tighter. Tighter. Oh, 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 oh my God. It explodes. Don't let it gross you out. Hallelujah. It explodes. Reborn. No gross out. This is a piece to rejoice in. out it flows, not just from that small opening, but from the center in one stream, like a laser beam. It exits in various shades of yellow and green, followed by blood. When you get that blood, you know it's gone. When that stubborn skin finally gave way after all that time, I thought I heard an audible expression, like a groan or a tired, breathless howl of someone who lost a long, long duel. I could swear it. I could swear I heard that sound, that voice. I grabbed some cotton balls and peroxide from the drawer of the night table beside the bed, remembering all the nights I applied it in frustration. But I didn't wash it yet. I kept on pressing. I wanted the last vestiges of that horror within. I wanted to prolong this feeling of victory. There was no sense of disgust for the slime or the pools that had formed on my sheets. All disgust was overwhelmed by joy. Besides, you must understand, this was not just some infected body fluids I was looking down on. To me, this was the return of all that bad cut street drug garbage I had been inserting with such precision after all those years. This was the toxic residue of all my past sins. There, I've said it. I didn't see pus. I saw the petty demons marching out. I saw putrefaction, then purification, like alchemy. It must putrefy before it can turn to gold. I felt new, fresh air being sucked into that cavity, like the cat. Another chance. The idol was in ruins. Do you understand what I'm telling you? I know you think it's sick, some fucked up fetish, no doubt, but I understand the nature of it, and now that sickness is healing. So am I. I might very well blow it again. I don't really know where I go from here, but at least I've raised my quality of living above cockroach level. New York is not the same, that's for certain. I feel, as I said, closer to my heart. I feel a comfort in being alone. And mama, I don't want to make the scene no more. But I'm not worrying about all that right now. I want to penetrate only this moment. I've pierced a veil. I've beaten an old, old enemy. And I'm tired and my mind is clear. My senses full. I could hear that bakery truck, in fact, just pulling away down on Broadway, leaving behind only bread and the stunned silence of New York City at 5:15 a.m. It's so quiet, I could hear the clicking of the traffic lights changing red to yellow to green, stop to go, walk. Wait. Yeah. The comparative literature professors love that one at colleges. Actually, I never read it there, so I wouldn't know. This is a poem now. This is called Eight Fragments for Kurt Cobain. Genius is not a generous thing. In return, it charges more interest than any amount of royalties can cover, and it resents fame with bitter vengeance. Pills and powders only placate it a while. Then it pulls you in a place where the planet's poles reverse, where the currents of electricity shift. Your body becomes a magnet and pulls to it despair and rotten teeth, cheese whiz, and guns whose triggers are shaped tenderly into a false lust. In timeless illusion. The guitar claws kept tightening, I guess, in your heart stem. The loops of feedback and distortion threaded right through Lucifer's wisdom teeth. And never stopped, they're reverberating in your mind. And from the stage, all the faces out front seem so hungry with an unbearably wholesome misunderstanding. From where they sat, you seem so far up there, high and live and diving. And instead, you were swamp crawling down deeper until you tasted the earth's own blood and chatted with the buzzing-eyed insects that heroin breeds. You should have talked more with the monkey, man. He's always willing to negotiate. I'm still paying him off. The greater the money and fame, the slower the pendulum of fortune swings. Your willpower could have sped it up, maybe, but you left that on an airplane because it wouldn't pass customs and immigration. Here's synchronicity for you. Your music tape was inside my Walkman when my best friend from summer camp called with the news about you. I listened then. It was all there. Your music kept cutting deeper and deeper valleys of sound, less and less light, until you hit solid rock. The drill bit broke, and the valley became a thin crevice, impassable in time, as time itself stopped. And the walls became vices of brilliant notes, pressing in, pressing in. Pressure. That's how diamonds are made. And that's where it sometimes all collapses down in on you. Then I translated your muttered lyrics, and the phrases were curious, like incognito libido and chalk skin bending. The words kept getting smaller and smaller until, separated from the music, each letter spilled out into a cartridge which fit only in the barrel of a gun. And you shoved that barrel in as far as possible, because that's where the pain came from. That's where the demons were digging. The world outside was blank. Its every cause was just a continuation of another unsolved effect. But Kurt, didn't the thought that you would never write another song, another feverish line or riff, make you think twice? That's what I don't understand, because it's kept me alive all these years above any wounds. God, if only you hadn't swallowed yourself into a coma in Rome. You could have gone to Florence, perhaps, and looked into the eyes of Bellini or Raphael's portraits. Perhaps inside them, you could have found a threshold back to beauty's arms, where it all began, no matter that you felt betrayed by her. That is always the cost, as Frank said, of a young artist's remorseless passion, which starts out as a kiss and follows like a curse. This is a new poem. I just wrote it, actually, yesterday and today. So it's not typed up yet. I hope it doesn't... I'm not writing over myself and I could read it. But at any rate, it's about being in the loony bin, you know? But I was imagining myself, a friend of mine was in there for 72 hours observation, you know, so they picked him up, he was all spaced out and shit. They took him in there for 72 hours observation. Then they either cut you loose or keep you for a long time. So it doesn't really have a title in the locked wing. The locked wing. That's kind of nice. The rape of the lock. The locked wing. Locked in the swing for 72, but I'm picturing myself in there. Locked in the swing for 72 hours. And the view in Congress, how sweet the city seems. It breaks my heart. The gorgeous goings on of morning. So many memories rising like hawks, part predator, part prey. Pretty young blonde woman comes into my room right this moment in real time. I smile at her looking up. She smiles back. But then she hisses and sneers at me. Hisses like, well, there are giant cockroaches in Madagascar, the island of Madagascar, that actually hiss in defense. They call them Madagascan hissing cockroaches. She hisses like that. I keep forgetting people are in this place because they've gone off the sad blue abyss. God, not TV in the morning. I'm not that bad off yet, am I? In New York City, there is an improbable intersection where Waverly Place actually meets and crosses through Waverly Place. It's true. That's where I met her. I miss the meals we shared in restaurants on streets, the darker the better, darker than this place even. I miss those meals with you on streets filled with cats, Victrola music, and a reckless vanity. In fact, I miss as much the meals we missed together, times you never showed. I'd eat alone, dialogue with the blue radiators. I'd never despair that you hadn't arrived. I knew you lived life faster than me now. And frankly, you could have it that way. How come no one ever sees a baby pigeon? Where are they until they are full-grown, ubiquitous, and total complete nuisances? When I was 6 years old, where the fuck are they? I've never seen a baby pigeon. I've never seen a middle-aged pigeon. Just the big fuckers that shit on you. And when I was 6 years old, on the fire escape beneath ours, I saw a robin's nest once. There was one egg. It was powder blue. My friend once met an Indian chief and said he had a prominent erection. But she always says that. What was it like for my father in World War II on the island of Saipan? I like the sound of that word, Saipan. It's like insomnia, a sound soft as hair on beach sand. I see a man in the corridor leaning dangerously against the white and lime walls. He had a small red transistor radio pressed up to his ear. The radio was like ones people kept in fallout shelters in the late 50s. A man once, I read, built a fallout shelter large enough for his children to roller skate in. It's great. And everybody outside is getting vaporized and the kids are ding. That would be a great little short movie. I thought the bomb drops, the kids skate. But the bomb drops, but we skate on, suckers. I thought the man against the wall was listening to the baseball game with his little radio, and I asked him the score. Chaos is the score, man, he replied loudly. And its numbers are written across reality day by day. What a genius, I thought. Dear God, I ask one thing. Don't show me your face. No theophany. Do not give me your name. Just brush your breathing like a wing across my pale, peeling cheek once more, as you did that desert dawn between Black Top and Joshua Tree outside Needles, California, the end of the Mojave. My first trip across America, 1969. The others still asleep, upright in a rental car. I swear I had no doubt that I merged a moment with your manifestation then, if only the meanderings of Malakut, before it recoiled and withdrew because of my cowardice toward a consistent, pure love that purple morning. I believe it is time you come again here behind these locked doors, the garden of bruised pomegranates. Strange what comes instead, the diving swallows I recall eating up the sky, dawn on the west beach, the aperture of the sun still softly lit, shuddering with humility. I spit into my hands as a benediction of water and air, but all my intentions rot. I spent it all. I'm sorry. Hi, my name's Bobby. I'll trade you 6 gray marbles for 1 red cat's eye. The future belongs to crowds. It will go with the movement of the mobs. Atrocities on this planet spring up daily like mushrooms in mist. Outside grace, but even then I kept a reverence for each second to second, minute to minute. In the city by birth, I learned to love the facades of old buildings, brownstone, flat iron. The pledges implied as their edges met the sky, always a new sky, better or worse, always a different sky. As Heraclitus said, you never step in the same river twice. Well, I believe you never step in the same river once, or sky. Those lines and railings and gargoyles on the city were to me like lakes or ancient willows to country boys, animate almost, as the sun slanted over them on the Lower East Side, light quivering across my warped window pane, as my hand quivers now on these cage windows. And I swear, some days back then, down there, I saw deers bolting out of Tompkins Square Park and up Avenue A as the hunters raised their rifles. I prayed their aim was off, or that several supernal lords would guide them to cloud cover, upward, gliding. The clouds were my forest. If I could only find a tree now to rest. If only someone would visit today. But who knows, I'm here, lonely in a locked wing. It's hard to grasp through the window on top of the building below, the virgin tracks of cats in snow, its paw prints are like the letters of an alphabet which only the inmates here could decipher. If only the African violet on the windowsill would bloom. If only the flames in my head would drop like leaves down my cool throat, extinguished and landing in my belly. If only they just let me use the phone. If only I had someone who's not here to talk to. If only these doctors understood the biochemical effects of self-pity. I mean, I love loneliness, but not locked loneliness. If only someone came to visit, a total stranger, or better, someone I knew, God, even a dog would do. That's a first draft. I'm going to read right now from Fear of Dreaming, and basically mainly the new poems, but and a couple of, you know, this has all the Living at the Movies in it, and the Book of Nods, and I edited out myself some of the stuff from the Book of Nods, because I couldn't understand why I published some of them. I'm going to rework them. There's potential there, but I shouldn't. I just threw everything that I had written during the rock and roll period to them, and they published it, you know. These good editors. This actually isn't published yet. As a result of spring, the mosquitoes are magnificent. From the point of view of the air, they are unfathomable. We don't deserve them. Mosquitoes are accustomed to considering themselves perfect. This year, they will withdraw with a mouth full of poets. Poets are to mosquitoes what cigarettes are to lung cancer. There are too many poets and not enough mosquitoes. To the mosquitoes, it's a matter of survival. One, a poet sees an owl and he thinks of a woman's crotch. Two, a mosquito sees a poet and he thinks of a woman's crotch. Poets and mosquitoes have one thing in common. They suck. Well, this is actually, I put music on my friend Alan Lanier. He's in the group The Blue Oyster Cult. He, one of my favorite bands. He played the keyboards. He also played guitar, but he did the music on keyboards for this, and it's coming out in some benefit record, like it's called Home Alive, I think. Not Home Alone, Home Alive. It's out of Seattle, you know. It's like a benefit. In memory of Mia Zapata, the girl from the band there who got raped and killed. Yeah, right on. And, you know, it's her friends who kind of put it together and stuff, that her band members and the women from 7 Year Bitch, who I dig a lot, too. So, you know, they wanted some spoken word stuff. They got all the big Seattle bands, and they even got an unreleased Nirvana cut. So I was glad to be on it. They asked me to put music to a poem, and so I did this with Alan, but I don't have the music now, sorry. Nightclubbing. I think it's coming out in January and stuff, since for a good cause. I ain't making nothing on it. Nightclubbing. For this generation, infected with too many antidotes, there must be a balcony, a height. You may be lifted up beyond the grip of glamour, of glory without rage, to initiate and incite the shaded dancers who are eager and anorexic, wearing monkey teeth on their wrists, lips, or fingers painted black, passing out affinity with the howling dog and their trousseau of darts, as the letters of their tattoos dissolve, leaving mermaids and flowers of banded hearts stranded without vows or names. I challenge you to restore a reckless elegance in place of the vapors you breathe, of boring, civilized distraction, to commit to sleep in a painless chamber the tedious pets of your cradled syringe. I can license you the malnourished but willing innocence of a cloudless destiny, and petition you to summon the mysteries with joy, not envy, to severing the crooked braces you insist on wearing, without blinding you with too much at once, the forgotten elements. I'm talking about a very slow first move, and carefully, carefully, as you reach, as I reach too, through a wheel of thorns to pump new air into the stray rose. I guess a love poem. Kind of bitchy love poem. It's like a divorce poem, you know. We're fucked, but we could be friends. Or we're fucked, but since I... It trips my steady breathing. When it comes, there is no one I can trust. It seems at times I have designed too well this vision of you. I cannot survive your eyes when they are scarred with the need for some lesser form of love. I admit to this conceit, and though you will not accept it, you love it nonetheless. It is just like you, and you're just like me. Our desires will always be kept sharp by a kind of perversity, a need to be each forever alone. Its colors are violet, like lips that have been smashed by night or robbed of blood by lack of breath. The wind I was speaking of, does this. There, I can feel it now. This is a new poem also. Real new. They'll never tell. Here is a piece of required reading. At the end of our century, the end of a millennium that began with the Crusades. The transcript of an interview between a Red Cross doctor and a Muslim girl in Bosnia, 12 years old, who described her rape by men calling themselves soldiers. Different men each night, one after the other, six, seven, eight of them for a week, while she was chained by the neck to a bed in her former schoolhouse, where she saw her parents and her brothers have their throats slit and tongues cut out, where her sister-in-law, 19 years old and nursing her baby, was also raped day after day, night after night, until she dared to beg for water because her milk had run dry. At which point, one of the men tore the child from her arms, and as if he were cutting an ear of corn, the girl's words, lopped off the child's head with a hunting knife, tossed it into the mother's lap, and raped the girl again, slapping her face, smearing it with her nephew's blood, and then shot the mother, who had begun to shriek hysterically with the wide-eyed child of hers on her lap. Shoving his gun into her mouth and firing twice. All of this recounted to the doctor in a monotone, a near whisper in a tent beside an icy river where the girl had turned up frostbitten, wearing only a soiled slip, her hair yanked out, her teeth broken, not bad, literally broken. All the history that you've ever read tells you that this is what men do. This is only a sliver of the reflection of the beast who is a fixture of human history and the places you heard of as a child that were his latest stalking grounds, Auschwitz, Dachau, Treblinka, Hiroshima, and the names of their dead and the numberless dead whose names have vanished each day now find their roles swelled with kindred souls. New names, new numbers from towns and villages that have been scorched right off the map. 1995 may as well be 1943. And it should be clear now that the beast in his many guises, the flags and vestments in which he wraps himself, and the elaborate titles he assumes can never, never be outrun. As that girl with the broken teeth loaded into an ambulance, strapped down on a stretcher so she wouldn't claw her own face, that girl will never outrun him, no matter where she goes, solitary or lost in a crowd. The line she follows, however straight or crooked, will always lead her back to that room. Like the chamber at the bottom of hell in the Quran, where the zaqam tree grows, watered by scalding rains, bearing fruit like devil's heads. In not giving her name, someone has noted at the end of the transcript that the girl herself could not or would not recall it, and then describes her as a survivor, which of course is from the Latin, meaning to live on, to outlive others, to continue moving onward. I, myself, would never have used that word. Yeah, I just got the big deal, so I don't have to do this shit anymore. See you later. Danny Goldberg here. Danny Goldberg, fans in the house? Actually, Danny Goldberg is married to my ex-wife. Yeah, ain't it strange? So these are like some new poems from the new section of poems in the new book. It's new, man. And my old wife, why am I talking about it tonight? This is called I Am Not Kurt Schwitters. I was like looking through this coffee table book of, you know, like German painters, and I was looking at Kurt Schwitters, who, unbeknownst to me at the time, is kind of enjoying this revival of his work, and especially he wrote a lot apparently too, and his work's been translated, his poems into English and stuff, and I notice them in the little magazines that they send and stuff, but looking at these paintings, I was trying to get some inspiration to write a poem from them, you know, and I couldn't think of a thing. The only thought that came to me after looking at them was that I am not Kurt Schwitters. So that's the title in the first line. I am not Kurt Schwitters. I am not Kurt Schwitters. I am not a blue rider tracking German cobblestone streets in snow in the old part of town, a port nowhere near. I am not Sal Mineo. I am not St. Bernard of Clairvaux, nor Abelard for that matter. I am not the stooped woman before dawn beneath the bridge and platform lights at the spit of the devil station, waiting too early for the train comes much later. I am not the moon tonight, thin crescent serrated like a Yemenite dagger. I am not Leo Szilard at the red traffic light. I am not what I am, not a wren on my fire escape. I am not Taras Bulba, wouldn't want to be. I am not a framer of the Constitution, not a Merovingian king, nor Charlemagne anointed by caprice. I am not a child of any czar, I don't think. I am not the corpse buried beneath snow, waiting for spring to be found. I am not Richard Nixon, neither a flaming monk of Buddha. I am not the sum of impositions, my own or others, nor subdued by destiny, but by my faith and its misgivings, by wills, abuses, misunderstanding, misjudgments. Without me, the oceans sleep like glass. The snows do not avalanche, changing continuously the shape of the mountain. This is called Fear of Dreaming. Too many teeth in this city are bared. What I want is to sleep inside a strange language, trimming the bonsai under glass, its redolent needles clipped precise as a Buddha's fingernails. Yet I'm nervous to sleep, afraid to dream, and fearful as well of waking too late. I'm wary of this century, its bloodthirsty and dead weight. This is just called Poem. The people down the hallway who stab each other each Friday night. Is that a ritual or just something terribly unresolved? This is a poem, I'll read this poem here. This is to the National Endowment of the Arts. Actually, the current president of the National Endowment of the Arts I like, but this is the previous president in the administration, and well, they're all in it. It's a fact that before his death, Robert Mapplethorpe placed 36 custom cameras with automatic timers set to last up to 9 years discreetly in various bedrooms of your board members, of your congressmen, of your senators, your cabinet, of your fantasies, your well-kept hidden lust and impotence, your dazzling hubris and inertia. So some night there'll be a flash. You'll barely notice. You think it's a distant lightning, perhaps, and I suppose in a way it is. It is heat lightning from his grave. It's a freeze frame of your virulent hypocrisy, which exposed loses all immunity in its systems, its censoring bureaucracy. It's a record to be collected someday soon by 36 righteous men who are waiting even now at your doors. This is called In Time, and the subtitle is AIDS. It's about a friend of mine. He's been a friend for like 20 years now, and he's been a drag queen since he was about 19. And he used to look fine, but nowadays, man, not looking too cool, man. But at least he's still alive. I admire that in a certain way, you know, any guy who could put on women's clothes and walk out in public. I mean, you know, doing it at home is another thing. We all do that. But going out, that's a big leap. Even opening, doing it with the curtains open is a big leap, man, when that lady across the way sees you. In time, AIDS. The sun shadows at dawn lay a splint on the streets below, as if they were broken last night by the sounds and prowling cold, and daylight arrives like a paramedic, setting the fractures by crudely snapping them into place once more. One day I'll learn you can't beat the odds dealt out in dreams by drawers with fever sores on their lips, reciting weekly fates to narcoleptics in bicycle shorts outside the welfare office in Chelsea. No wonder I lose my sense of time, wondering, worrying if those friends have learned that lesson downtown and west at the docks. Will the slaughterhouses leave open their trucks' tailgates at night so the conquistadors and sedated snake charmers can have a small place in dead-scented darkness to dance around the howling sombrero? No matter that they forego frostbite when they're on the row in satin and spangled pumps, it's the price a man pays to cross-dress in winter, the price to wear taffeta in snow and night and frost, driven. To be modern in the city is to be a victim in time. Since that time, my brother, since that time. When they were doing the movie, The Basketball Diaries, they asked, you know, aside from the old stuff they had in the soundtrack album, they asked me if I would do something new, you know, and actually, I don't need these now, if I would do something new, and, you know, so they gave me studio money, and I did, like, a few songs with this band from Seattle, and they were like rockers. One was a dirge, one was a straight rocker, and that was cool because I was able to write the lyric from the point of view of a 15-year-old kid again, and that felt terrific, you know. It had lines like, I'm a divine disgrace, but I could jam in your face. And let me see. Now I'm on the street again. When it calls you, then you just cannot resist. Now I'm an orphan, sleeping with the coffin, just like Oliver Twist. I like the verse was, but since a worm, the chorus, but since a worm turned, I have learned this apple is just a blood-filled tear, and I fall down laughing. I fall down laughing. I fall down laughing and I disappear. So that was the rocker song. And And then there was this dirge song. And but then Lenny Kaye, my old guitar player, and Patty's guitar player, who's actually producing, right as we speak, the new Patti Smith album. Yeah, they're back together. It's cool. Well, not the entire troupe, of course. Richard Soule, Death in Venice, as we DNV, Death in Venice, as we call him, was he died unfortunately, and Ivan is Kral is back in Europe, so and Lenny and JD and new keyboard player and new bass player, but they never had a bass player actually, but they have one now. But at any rate, Lenny played me this song. And it was so different from, you know, like anything I'd done. And he had some like gibberish lyrics enough so he had the phrasing down that he was singing on it. So I said, well, you don't really have the lyrics, right? He said, no, I'm not married to these lyrics. And so I said, well, listen, man, I'd like to, you know, because I was just in the studio with him because I wanted him to produce the vocals. The Seattle band sent the tracks to me in New York, and I did the vocals there, and I wanted Lenny to produce it. And so he said, he played me that song. I said, let's do this one, man. I'll write some lyrics and do it, because it was really different, and I thought it would be really good for a movie. And when I wrote the lyrics for this, I realized afterward I was writing them, like, from now, looking back on that period, as it was in the movies or in the book, in both, really. So this is, I hope I can remember the lyrics after all this shit. It's called The Beast Within. If you open your ear, I'll whisper you when. That will soothe your burnt blood. Such exquisite fear. Breathing the air filled with powders and porn. Now comes the dawn. If I release the dove, would it betray the sky and return to your cage? Wearing your glove. Can I fold back the pages and just take one look into your jungle book? Some say it's a lie, some say it's a sin. Do you know how it ends if you won't let it begin? You feel it waking now beneath your skin. You can't live without the beast within. If I lift up your veil, I'll finish the features that aren't quite done. How could we fail? With all the miraculous masks that we wear in shadows and stares. So let's seal out the day. Oh, your eyes like morning, naked and wet. What price will we pay? Come on now, think back. Tell me how we ever got here. Such tender years. Some say it's a lie. Some say it's a sin. Do you know how it ends if you let it begin? You feel it waking now beneath your skin. Can't live without the beast within, and you could call call it a lie. Could say it's a sin. Do you know how to end if you won't let it begin? And you can't pass it to your next of kin. You can't live without the beast within. You can't live without the beast within. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. My pleasure. Thanks a lot, man. It's my pleasure.
Thank you very much, folks. It's been a pleasure. There'll be a band on in just a little while if you want to hang out.
Zedekiah Pariah from the Harlots on the mouth harp, blistering. What time is it? It's one.
Rave up.
Oh my God! Can we do rave? Yeah, sure we can.
Yeah, we can do anything. Thank you.
Hey, Tony, what time is it? Okay, let's get Swoon 23, a couple of the cats from Swoon 23.
Yeah!
Fuck yeah. Hey, Chris. Hey, Chris.
You know, I know you've heard the legend of the Dandy Warhols. Yeah, well, this is all our friends. Good to meet you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I went to high school with this man, Chris McCarty. And Doug Lindstrom. Hey, go see Thrill Billy, too, for a shit-kicking good time. Thrill Billy. They're hot.
Please come to the stage. Spike, please come to the stage.
You need your guitar, Spike.